Do you know what is the first thing you require to transform yourself and your life? It's becoming uncomfortable with your current state. The moment you start becoming uncomfortable with your pain and suffering, you start opening up a doorway to move up to the best version of yourself. You know, most people do not choose to design an extraordinary life for themselves because they have grown comfortable with the pain and sufferings of their current life. And the first prerequisite to improve your life, to create a new destiny for yourself, is to become aware whether your present circumstances are leading you upwards in life or they are moving you downwards in life. The first words that Lord Krishna, you know, spoke in the starting of Bhagavad Gita, they are Shri Bhagwan Anuvacha Kutastva Kashmal Midam Vishme Samapasthitam Anarye Jushtam Aswargye Akirti Karam Arjuna. Shri Bhagwan Uvacha. He says the second chapter of Bhagavad Gita is Sankhya Yoga. Lord Krishna, you know, condenses the teachings of entire Bhagavad Gita in this chapter. And this chapter is the essence of the entire Gita. There are four main topics of Sankhya Yoga which are covered here. The first is the power of surrender. You know, Arjuna completely surrenders himself to Lord Krishna and accepts Lord Krishna as his guru. He requests Lord Krishna to guide him on how to tide over his sorrow. The second is the ignorance of the true nature of the self. That is the cause of all pain and suffering in our life. Third is the essence of Karma Yoga, the discipline of selfless action without being attached to its fruits. And fourth is the description of a perfect man, one whose mind is steady and one-pointed. So today we shall be going very, very deep into the aspect of our own delusion. So stay with us till the end. And this is the first lecture, you know, of the series on your journey to becoming a superhuman or becoming a perfect man. And I can guarantee you that if you are able to just follow the entire series of these lectures on Bhagavad Gita, your life would never be the same again. And if you have not subscribed till now, I suggest you to subscribe to this channel so that you do not miss out on the forthcoming videos in this series. But before we start, kindly allow me to pay my gratitude to my guru, you know, without whose blessings I wouldn't have been drawn towards surrender and devotion to God. Om Ram Shri Kanhaiya Lal Sharmaye Namaha. Om Shri Guruve Namaha. You know, chapter 2 of Bhagavad Gita, it starts with Sanjay, you know, continuing to explain to Maharaj Dhritarashtra that what is happening on the battlefield of Kurukshetra and what happened after Arjun put down his bow, Dandi, and he sat in his chariot saying that I shall not fight. Sanjay said, seeing Arjuna full of compassion, his mind depressed, his eyes full of tears, he says, Madhusudana spoke the following words. Now, it is important to note that Lord Krishna is addressed here as Madhusudan. Madhusudan means the killer of the demon Madhu. You know, it was actually Lord Vishnu who killed the demon Madhu, not Lord Krishna in his Visavatara. But Sanjay, he is a virtuous man. And with his divine vision, he knew that Lord Krishna was not an ordinary man, but he is the Supreme God himself. So thus, Lord Krishna is always addressed as Shri Bhagwan. You know, the opening sentence of this shloka is Shri Bhagwan Uvacha. Lord Krishna is called Bhagwan because he possesses six bhagas or the divine traits. The meaning of the term Bhagwan, you know, is explained by Parashar Muni. He is the father of Ved Vyas, and he explained it in Vishnu Purana. He says, Aishwaryas, Samagras, Dharmas, Yashas, Shriya, Gyan, Vairagya, Yogas, Chayav, Shashanam, Bhaga, Iti, Rana. He says, as the Supreme Personality who possesses all the six Kalyan Gunas, namely the Jnana, that is knowledge, Vairagya, which means total dispassion, Virya is the capacity to create, sustain and resolve, Yashas means absolute fame, and Shri is all the wealth, and Aishwarya means overlordship. So to have all knowledge, Jnana, is to be free from all ignorance. Thus, the one who has all jnana, you know, does not require a mind. If we require a mind to know, there is always ignorance. Therefore, whoever is endowed with a mind in order to know cannot be a Bhagwan. So Bhagwan is free from mind. Then the one who has absolute dispassion or Vairagya has got no longing, he has got no insecurity, he or she is full of, he is a full or poorn. Then Virya is the absolute power or Shakti. It is the capacity to create, to sustain and to resolve. The one who has this absolute power is called the Almighty. And Yashas means all the fame, and Shri is wealth. So the Lord or Bhagwan has all the wealth, you know, all they have all the resources, and any wealth that you, me, anyone may have, it actually belongs to Bhagwan. It actually belongs to the Lord, and you and me are only the trustee of that wealth during this lifetime. And finally, the one who is not caused, one who is not ruled by anyone, who is not subject to the laws of someone else, has the Bhaga called Aishwarya or overlordship. So these six absolute virtues, they constitute Bhaga, and the one who has this sixfold Bhaga is called Bhagwan. So Bhagwan Shri Krishna says, my dear Arjun, kutastva, where from have you, you know, kashmalam idam, got this delusion in this hour of peril? It is not befitting an honorable person. It leads not to the higher abodes, but it leads to disgrace. So the word Arya here does not refer to any race or ethnic group. The Manu Smriti, you know, defines an Aryan as a very highly evolved and a very cultured person. Aryan connotes a model human being, you know, kind of a perfect gentleman, a perfect person. And the sole purpose of all spirituality is to induce the humans to become Aryans in all respects, which means become their best versions. So Bhagwan Shri Krishna, he finds Arjun's present condition, you know, in conflict with that ideal, with that ideal person. So Arjun, who is considered manly, you know, he is full of vigor and virya, but he suddenly sinks into unmanliness, you know, at the moment of a crisis in this war. So therefore, Lord Krishna, he reprimands him of getting diverted from his path. Hence, he termed him as an Aryan. So the Bhagavad Gita, you know, effectively begins from here, because Bhagwan Shri Krishna starts speaking from this verse. Just look deeply at the process, how Lord Krishna is first inducing a hunger for knowledge in Arjuna. You know, the first thing he does is to point out to Arjuna that his state of delusion or his confusion is dishonorable and is inappropriate for a virtuous person. He uses the term an Arya, which is unlike an Arya, which is unlike a model human being. So this makes Arjun become aware that his mental condition is not one that of an evolved human being or an Aryan. And then Lord Krishna goes on to remind Arjun of the consequences of delusion. He says, Aswargayam, means which does not lead to the higher abodes. Swarg, as you all know, Swarg is the heavenly abode. But Aswarg is opposite to Swarg, that is hell. And you all know how much pain and suffering a soul undergoes when he is put into hell. So, and Lord Krishna also uses the word Akirtikaram. Kirti means fame and glory, but Akirti means disgrace, shame. So, Akirtikaram is one which is disgraceful, which is leading to pain, which is leading to infamy, which is leading to failure in life, which is leading to degradation of the soul. Now, can you see how Lord Shri Krishna is making Arjun uncomfortable, you know, about his current state? Now, let's look at the kind of words that Lord Krishna is using. You know, they were not words of kindness. They were not words of sympathy or support. They were tough, provocative words. They were meant to shake Arjun out of his deluded state of mind. So instead of comforting Arjun, Lord Krishna is making him aware that his mental state is not appropriate by using these three words, Anarya, Aswargayam, and Akirtikaram. Now, do you realize what is that which propels us to find meaning in our life? What is that which motivates us to make our lives better? It is that initial feeling of discomfort, of discontentment, of a knowing that our current state is not appropriate. That is the first stage. It is that knowledge which, if properly channeled, can become a very, very powerful impetus for us to become Aryan or to become the best version of ourselves. Therefore, you know, God sometimes deliberately puts us or puts somebody in turmoil so that he or she may be forced to search for knowledge to remove that confusion. But those of us who keep blaming God, you know, for their turmoils, they continue to sink deeper and deeper into more pain and suffering. It's only those who are able to realize that their turmoil is the result of their own delusion, that their turmoil is a way which is shown by God to start moving towards true knowledge and to move towards their better self. So the message of Lord Krishna is very, very clear, that the goal of life or success cannot be attained by the weak. To be firm in body, to be firm in mind, to be firm in character is born out of strength. This world and the next world are for the strong. And strength brings forth right conduct and straightforwardness, you know, leading to enjoyment of this world and reaching the godhood. All divine traits, they have their source in strength. Strength is life. Weakness is death. So write in the comments below, which of the six bhagas or divine traits you wish to adopt yourself to become an ideal person, to become an Aryan who is full of godly qualities. And your resolve to transform yourself would enable you to design an extraordinary life for yourself. If you wish to learn more secrets to design an extraordinary life, you can join my free workshop whose link is given below. And in my free workshop, I tell you the secrets to design your extraordinary life. And I am your brother guide to prosperity. And my mission is to help you realize the dreams of your life and help you achieve something worthwhile in life for which your family, your parents, and your children can be proud of.